56 million.
Did you know that birth control pills actually cause early silent abortion? Most people think that birth control pills simply prevent a woman from getting pregnant, which is sometimes the case. However, birth control pills also act as an abortifacient, snuffing out a young life that has already begun. Not only that, but the Bible actually condemns other birth control methods as well. In our modern society, birth control is something that most people take for granted and have never even questioned. But we as Christians are commanded by the Bible to prove all things. And in the course of this film, you will learn the shocking truth about birth control.
And so the pill causes the uterus to contract and the embryo around 12 to 24 hours.
Currently in the United States, surgical pill is used by over 11 million women, many of whom are unaware of its mechanisms of action, even though they are printed on the packaging. Our message today is that the pill kills babies with abortifacient effects.
Birth control pills cause silent abortions. If you are taking birth control pills, you are inadvertently literally killing your children. And remember, this is the most commonly used birth control method. So before we get into the subject from the Bible of whether birth control is right or wrong, let me just start out by saying that the most commonly used, the most popular method of birth control, the one that 4 out of 5 women have used, is a pill that will literally cause your unborn children to die. Let me start out by proving to you from the Bible that life begins at conception. Look down at your Bible at Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14.
Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel.
Now flip over, if you would, to Matthew chapter 1, because in Matthew chapter 1, this exact scripture is quoted in the New Testament. In the Old Testament it said, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son. Well, in Matthew chapter 1, verse 23, the Bible reads,
behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth the son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with him.
So isn't it interesting that in the Old Testament it says conceive, and in the New Testament it says shall be with child? You know what that tells me? That conception produces a child. Not a blastocyst or an embryo or a fetus, but God considers that a child. When we talk about life beginning at conception, the devil loves to change the meaning of words. Now, conception has historically always meant fertilization. When the seed from the man and the egg from the woman come together and that egg is fertilized, that has been known as conception. But now they're starting to change the definition. And even in some dictionaries, they'll put a definition that says, well, it's fertilization or implantation.
Dr. Vanessa Cullen, Vice President for Medical Affairs at Planned Parenthood Federation of America, was asked if hormonal birth control pills cause abortion. Her response was, no, abortion ends a pregnancy. Contraception pills work before pregnancy begins. Pregnancy begins with the implantation of the developing fertilized egg in a woman's uterus. Yet, in the next paragraph, she admits, implantation doesn't...
Hey, are you straight? Yeah? Well, so is uncooked spaghetti, and that shit's easy. So, think about it.
And each time you listen, it helps you see yourself in a whole new winning way. So keep listening. The self-talk you're hearing is all about you.
To win, and you know what determination has done for you in the past, and you know you're going to have even more of it in the future. This cassette program.
Me and my friend want to tell you that we find you really attractive.
Like, we think you're really handsome and all that. Like,
don't go to hell, guys. Visualize yourself putting these positive self-suggestions to work. Imagine yourself in pictures in your mind already having non-stop determination. Along with the cassette tape, use the affirmation cards in the bottom of the program. Keep your favorite cards in front of you where you can't miss them and where you'll see them often. Now, as you begin, there are a few things you should know about yourself and about the kind of determination for winning that you already have within you. You are persistent. You are 100% committed to reaching the goals that you set for yourself. You make your own decisions. You have a clearly defined purpose in everything that you do. You never let defeat or failure stand in your way. You always keep moving and you always keep winning. You have a good attitude about yourself. You keep yourself in shape and in winning condition. You have made the decision to be a winner and you are a winner. You are strong, willful, steadfast, resolute, persistent, and determined. Does that sound like you? Yes, it does. That is you, more and more every day. You are a winner. Every time you talk to yourself about self-determination for winning, here are some things that you say. I know that an insubstantial amount of determination is the ultimate ingredient.
Let's
and
get
I
one thing.
Yeah,
well, I
know that in any success plan, determination is the ultimate ingredient.
And how do you know you're straight if you
and I have determination.
The homo thing is annoying.
I know that in any success plan, determination is the ultimate ingredient. And I have determination. I am a winner.
If someone blatantly disrespects your pronouns, does that mean you have every right to kill them?
I am steadfast and persistent
like, oh,
in the pursuit
right.
of my
no,
goals,
you have the whole
and I will
get
not give up. I am a winner. I am absolutely determined to achieve my aims. I am steadfast and persistent in the pursuit of my goals, and I will not give up. I am a winner. I am absolutely determined to achieve my aims. I am steadfast and persistent in the pursuit of my goals, and I will not give up. I am totally committed to the achievement of the objectives which I set for myself. Not 50% or 99%, but 100% committed to the full realization of my goals. I am totally committed to the achievement of the objectives which I set for myself. Not 50% or 99%, but 100% committed to the full realization of my goals.
I am not silent about slushing.
I am totally committed to the achievement of the objectives which I set for myself. Not 50% or 99%, but 100% committed to the full realization of my goals. I am a winner. I make decisions about myself. I set my own goals. I determine my own course and direction. And I allow no one else to make these decisions for me. I am a winner. I make decisions about myself. I set my own goals. I determine my own course and direction. And I allow no one else to make these decisions for me. I am a winner. I make decisions about myself.
I'm awesome.
I set my own goals. I determine my own course and direction. And I allow no one else to make these decisions for me.
Send me hate.
An accurate description of me would include the words strong, willful, decisive, steadfast, resolute, persistent, and determined. An accurate description of me would include the words strong, willful, decisive, steadfast, resolute, persistent, and determined.
You're just
an accurate description of me would include the words strong, willful, decisive, steadfast, resolute, persistent, and determined. I am a winner because I know what I want and I go for it. I am a winner because I know what I want and I go for it. I am a winner because I know what I want and I go for it.
Guess what? Gender fluid. I even explained that I
think
intersectional women would be like guys.
Does not stand in my way. I know that what most call failures are nothing more than detours along the way. So I move past them and keep on going.
So I got a new binder.
What others call defeat or failure does not stand in my way. I know what most call failures are nothing more than detours along the way. So I move past them and keep on going. What others call defeat or failure does not stand in my way. I know that what most call failures are nothing more than detours along the way. So I move past them and keep on going. No defeat is ever the end of the road for me. I know that roads don't stop, people do. But I make sure that my road keeps going, and so do I. I keep myself moving, and that keeps me moving. No defeat is ever the end of the road for me. I know that roads don't stop, people do. So I make sure that my roads keep going, and so do I. I keep myself moving, and that keeps me moving.
There's nothing intrinsically real about a name that you're given at birth.
No defeat is ever the end of the road for me.
So today someone called me a girl who looks like a boy.
So I make sure that my roads keep going, and so do I. I keep myself moving, and that keeps me moving. Winning.
And you get really confused.
I have courage. I meet my challenges with the confidence of knowing that I have the stamina to endure.
So if you're a trans woman that's a lesbian, wouldn't it be easy if you just say straight man?
I have courage. I meet my challenges with the confidence of knowing that I have the stamina to endure and the determination to succeed.
If somebody is non-binary and you do not agree with that,
I meet my challenges with the confidence of knowing that I have the stamina to endure and the determination to succeed.
That means you're a girl. Mm-hmm.
I have a healthy attitude about myself.
Just because you see these,
I genuinely
guys like
make me
myself. Any less non-binary.
I have a positive self-image and a lot of respect for who I am. I have a healthy attitude about myself. I genuinely like myself. I have a positive self-image and a lot of respect for who I am. I have a healthy attitude about myself. I genuinely like myself. I have a positive self-image and a lot of respect for who I am. I like my values and I feel good about myself and about the goals that I set for myself. Of course I want to get even better, and I believe that I always will. But I like who I am today too. I am a winner.
You're just getting
like
the wrong idea because they did not. I literally have evidence
I
right
like
here.
I like my values and I feel good about myself and about the goals that I set for myself. Of course I want to get even better, and I believe that I always will. But I like who I am today too. I am a winner, and I like being me. I like my values and I feel good about myself and about the goals that I set for myself. Of course I want to get even better. And I believe that I always will.
Stop killing trans women. Stop killing trans women. Stop.
They say girls drool and boys rule, but
because
really
I accept myself and like who I am, I know that I really deserve the right to win in my life. And that gives me the determination to win more every day. In a positive and worthwhile way. Because I accept myself and like who I am, I know that I really deserve the right to win in my life. And that gives me the determination to win more every day and in the most positive and worthwhile way. Because I accept myself and like who I am, I know that I really deserve the right to win in my life. And that gives me the determination to win more every day in the most positive and worthwhile way. As I read or hear these words and
my makeup looks this fierce,
mind,
just makes me want to dismantle.
I recognize my absolute determination to reach all the goals that I've set for myself in every area of my life, at my work, and in my personal life. As I read or hear these words
about
and
you.
Visualize their money.
Look better without makeup
mind,
because no one told them that they had look better.
My absolute
ooh, destroying the patriarchy. One thing
all
I took
of the goals that I set for myself.
Destruction of the patriarchy.
Area of my
smash
life.
The patriarchy.
At my work,
people still today think that all entertainment has to do with movies, drama, is therefore nothing more than this entertainment. It never ever was that case.
Of course, television can't perform such miracles as this. Yes, but perhaps there's no harm with that it could.
The greatest social messages are promoted through movies and drama, high drama, through the fixation of emotive sequences, emotional sequences, not logical, factual sequences, but pushing points across in an emotional way which register and fix in the mind. So emotional content is very, very important, rather than going through an actual discussion or an argument using logic and facts. There's no debate. And when you're being downloaded to fiction, your guard is down, the sensor part of your brain is not in action. It isn't saying, yes, I agree with this, I disagree with that, as you would in a debate or a lecture. You're actually in an alpha state, being completely downloaded with new ideas.
Throughout history, social engineers have refined techniques designed to control large populations.
About 100 years ago, this big organization with many branches, the one who can rule the world basically, using Britain as a nucleus of a system, an embryo, which also was going to be joined with the US under the Anglo-American establishment. It was about the kind of culture and the changes of culture over a 100-year period that they would actually design, implement, and bring in. And H.G. Wells talked about it too. He talked about arenas. He says arenas could be put up across the world for sports, for instance. Now, at that time, sports was something that children, school children were into. Adults became adults and were onto adult things. So it was unimaginable at the time that people could actually believe that there's even a need for adult sports and entertainment, never mind having arenas built across the world. But he said we can do this. And foist basically a sports culture for the males.
It used to be rainy, and now it's
using
sunny.
Using a tribal system, we're all tribal to an extent, that's why I'm even bothered to vote for a tribal leader. This is well understood, that's why we're supplied with these leaders. And because the average man has become more disengaged from his own destiny, as the expert class arose, it was decided that the males would get their outlet, basically. Being gradually becoming helpless as males through sports. Therefore, they'd have a tribal team they could identify with, they could cheer them on as they were winning. In their own personal lives, they were getting nowhere. They were getting disenfranchised in a sense, as experts took over decision making for them in all kinds of fields. So, this was psychology that used planned before they even implemented the sports. When radio came along, of course, they used that. The maximum sports for the men, soaps basically for the women, and then in came television, as I say, with its alpha state, its hypnotic state, and sure enough, around the 1960s, really, 50s and 60s, it took off, it really took off, and men became glued on Saturday nights to the sports shows. A culture industry, which is called by its own the culture industry. The Soviet Union had a department called the culture industry. Their actors and directors were called the cultural leaders. Leaders. Because they would, on a computer, people are computers. All you have to do is keep giving them new updates every so often, and you can change an entire country or a nation or a block of nations. We're all getting the same upgrades at the same time along certain paths. Today we call it political correctness. Most people want to belong to their peer group. They want to be the same as everyone else when it comes to opinions. In fact, they judge their own personal sanity by bouncing ideas off their neighbors and friends. will answer back and agree on the same topics and points. It doesn't matter if the topics or what you're getting at facts are utter nonsense, as long as everyone agrees at the same time to see what I'm saying, and your friends will all agree because they've had the same information given to them.
But they've been programmed. I'm sad because I know that it's hard for people like that to take an interest, a serious interest in world affairs, take a serious interest in what their elected officials are doing, and they're not going to be really inclined to study or discover the deception that's being used against them. So I'm sad because I see all of that in a flash in my mind as being an indication of how easy it is for the masses to be manipulated.
The scientific dictatorship understands what makes human beings tick. They understand our psychology. They've studied it, and they're using it against us. But the minute the public awakens to the fact that there is an agenda to manipulate them, and the second the public realizes that they are being conditioned and controlled, the establishment begins to lose that edge they got over people. So all I ask viewers to do is to think for themselves and to study public relations, to study advertising, to study propaganda, and to realize how much of it is out there in their daily lives. And then make the decision for yourself. I just want people to think on their own and to not have their decisions and their thoughts and their ideas prepackaged and basically downloaded into them.
If it's on TV and a famous face says something, then it must be true. He doesn't have to show you facts or anything else. You've been brought up with these faces. That's why they keep these guys on television into the 70s and 80s. You've grown up with this father figure who's on television every night at 6 o'clock. In your house, in your room, staring right at you, and as a father figure, would he tell you a lie? That so you naturally never suspect him. And this same man will lead you to new topics. He'll introduce experts on the topics. He'll have a little summary at the end of every talk, and you are now left with the conclusion that's presented to you. You don't arrive at it, it's given to you, it's good enough for you.
When I was growing up, people were talking on their front porches, neighbors were playing baseball, there were nightly barbecues. You don't see that anymore. We've lost our community. You drive through neighborhoods, you see the blue glow of television sets. We're losing our humanity. So, if you want to rebel against the globalists, the social engineers, start by turning the TV off a few hours a day and actually getting to know your neighbors. Getting outside that comfort zone, expanding your horizons. By coming together as communities, by getting to know our neighbors, we defeat the social engineers.
We're programmed today perfectly, just like machines. We tie this in with the Brzezinski. Brzezinski said in Two Ages, this guy was way up at the NSA. He was a master geopolitician. He works, mostly works in 2015 periods to do geopolitics in other countries. But he said himself, the public will shortly be unable to think or reason for themselves. He was meaning by the form of information that was given to the type, the formulas that were in use then in the 1970s. He says, eventually they'll be unable to think or reason for themselves. And eventually, he said, they will expect the media to do all their thinking and reasoning for them. Well, that's happened today. That's why people today can't think outside of the programming from television.
Zbigniew Brzezinski, Obama's main foreign policy advisor, talks about how a cult of personality can be artificially manufactured to influence the masses.
That wasn't okay either.
First months of my administration.
But this is the big
problem.
This is the big problem.
Sorry about that. Pull our economy back from the brink, including the largest, most sweeping economic recovery plan in the nation's history.
We were gullible, but also willingly gullible. We want a human being, a big daddy, to come along and make everything right for us. And as long as we believe that, we'll always basically be shafted.
In addition to John, sorry, I just noticed that I jumped the gun here. Go ahead and move it up. I had already introduced all you guys.
It's the Presidential Reality Show. When it became an Oprah production, it became Slick. You don't have a president. You have an actor. They say that politics is show business for ugly people. You got it.
What am I going to tell the friends when I tell him his teleprompter is broken? What will he do then?
It's Obama's role to front the international banking syndicate and to take all the heat for their unpopular agenda. It's his job to convince the American people that the buck actually stops at the White House.
In Brzezinski's book, Between the Ages, is that eventually we shall put presidents in who will have personality cults. We shall create massive personality cults for these people through the same techniques as Hollywood has used. Obama is that man.
Globalists who know that Obama is going to promote their plan want to make him such a superhero that nobody will question what he's doing. They'll be so preoccupied with who he is or where he is or what he's saying or what he's wearing or something like that. The idea of making him into a celebrity is very valuable because that way people are less inclined to ask, what is he doing?
Similar plans of social control have been continuously carried out by operatives of the Ford Foundation, who Obama has worked for over the last 30 years. Many of the strategies used to control populations were originally developed by Edward Bernays, who coined the phrase public relations. Bernays said that if you manufacture an authoritative figure who repeats the same messages over and over, that this will appeal to the masses' subconscious desires.
Yes, we can.
The unwashed masses will helplessly follow the leader and go along with any message they spout.
Yes, we can. Yes, we can. We shall overcome. Yes, we can. We will respond with that timeless creed that sums up the spirit of a people.
But it doesn't really.
Yes, we can. Thank you.
Today, these exact techniques are being used with devastating effect against the general population. Obama is the latest version of 21st century mass mind control.
The revelation of Jesus Christ. Chapter 1. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him, to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass. And he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John, who bare record of the word of God and of the testimony of Jesus Christ, and of all things that he saw. Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein. For the time is at hand. John, to the seven churches which are in Asia. Grace be unto you and peace from him which is, and which was, and which is to come, and from the seven spirits which are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, and the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth. And to him that loved us, and washed us from our sins in his own blood, and hath made us kings and priests unto God and his Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him, and all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so. Amen. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, saith the Lord, which is and which was and which is to come, the Almighty. I, John, who also am your brother and companion in tribulation and in the kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ, was in the isle that is called Patmos for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day and heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet, saying,
I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last. And what thou seest, write in a book and send it unto the seven churches which are in Asia, unto Ephesus, and unto Smyrna, and unto Pergamos, and unto Thyatira, and unto Sardis, and unto Philadelphia, and unto Laodicea. And I turned to see the voice that spake with me. And being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks. And in the midst of the seven candlesticks, one like unto the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the foot, and girt about the paps with a golden girdle. His head and his hairs were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire, and his feet like unto fine brass, as if they burned in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters. And he had in his right hand seven stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was as the sun shineth in his strength. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. And he laid his right hand upon me, saying unto me, Fear not, I am the first and the last. I am he that liveth and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And have the keys of hell and of death. Write the things which thou hast seen, and the things which are, and the things which shall be hereafter. The mystery of the seven stars which thou sawest in my right hand, and the seven golden candlesticks. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven candlesticks which thou sawest are the seven churches. Chapter 2. Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write, These things saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. I know thy works, and thy labor, and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil, and thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not, and hast found them liars, and hast borne, and hast patience, and for my name's sake hast labored, and hast not fainted. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. Remember therefore from whence thou art fallen, and repent, and do the first work. Or else I will come unto thee quickly, and will remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent. But this thou hast, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. And unto the angel of the church in Smyrna write, These things saith the first and the last, which was dead and is alive. I know thy works and tribulation and poverty, but thou art rich. And I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews and are not, but are the synagogue of Satan. Fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer. Behold, the devil shall cast some of you into prison, that ye may be tried, and ye shall have tribulation 10 days. Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. He that overcometh shall not be hurt of the second death. And to the angel of the church in Pergamos write, These things saith he which hath the sharp sword with two edges. I know thy works, and where thou dwellest, even where Satan's seat is. And thou holdest fast my name, and hast not denied my faith, even in those days wherein Antipas was my faithful martyr, who was slain among you where Satan dwelleth. But I have a few things against thee, because thou hast there them that hold the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel, to eat things sacrificed unto idols, and to commit fornication. So hast thou also them that hold the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which thing I hate. Repent, or else I will come unto thee quickly, and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh,
will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name written, which no man knoweth, saving he that receiveth it. And unto the angel of the church in Thyatira write, These things saith the Son of God, who hath his eyes like unto a flame of fire, and his feet are like fine brass. I know thy works, and charity, and service, and faith, and thy patience, and thy works, and the last to be more than the first. Notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce my servants to commit fornication, and to eat things sacrificed unto idols. And I gave her space to repent of her fornication, and she repented not. Behold, I will cast her into a bed, and them that commit adultery with her into great tribulation, except they repent of their deeds. And I will kill her children with death. And all the churches shall know that I am he which searcheth the reins and hearts. And I will give unto every one of you according to your works. But unto you I say, and unto the rest in Thyatira, as many as have not this doctrine, and which have not known the depths of Satan as they speak, I will put upon you none other burden, but that which ye have already, hold fast till I come. And he that overcometh and keepeth my works unto the end, to him will I give power over the nations. And he shall rule them with a rod of iron. As the vessels of a potter shall they be broken to shivers, even as I received of my Father. I will give him the morning star. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. Chapter 3. And unto the angel of the church in Sardis write, These things saith he that hath the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know thy works, thou hast a name that thou livest and art dead. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die, for I have not found thy works perfect before God. Remember therefore how thou hast received and heard, and hold fast and repent. If therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come on thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I will come upon thee. Thou hast a few names, even in Sardis, which have not defiled their garments, and they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, These things saith he that is holy, he that is true, he that hath the key of David, he that openeth, and no man shutteth, and shutteth, and no man openeth. I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it. For thou hast a little strength, and hast kept my word, and hast not denied my name. Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews and are not, but do lie, behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet, and to know that I have loved thee. Because thou hast kept the word of my patience, I also will keep thee from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth. Behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown. Him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go no more out. And I will write upon him the name of my God, and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven from my God, and I will write upon him my new name. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. And unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, These things saith the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou wert cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm, and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Because thou sayest, I am rich, and increased with goods, and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched, and miserable, and poor, and blind, and naked, I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear. and anoint thine eyes with eyesight, that thou mayest see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous therefore and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him, and he with me. To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and am set down with my Father in his throne. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. Chapter 4. After this, I looked, and behold, a door was opened in heaven. And the first voice which I heard was as it were of a trumpet talking with me, which said, Come up hither, and I will show thee things which must be hereafter. And immediately I was in the Spirit. And behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one sat on the throne. And he that sat was to look upon like a jasper and a sardine stone. And there was a rainbow round about the throne, in sight like unto an emerald. And round about the throne were 24 seats, and upon the seats I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white raiment, and they had on their heads crowns of gold. And out of the throne proceeded lightnings and thunderings and voices. There were 7 lamps of fire burning before the throne, which are the 7 spirits of God. And before the throne there was a sea of glass like unto crystal. And in the midst of the throne, and round about the throne, were 4 beasts, full of eyes, before and behind. And the first beast was like a lion, and the second beast like a calf, and the third beast had a face as a man, and the fourth beast was like a flying eagle. And the 4 beasts had each of them 6 wings about him, and they were full of eyes within. And they rest not day and night, saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord God Almighty, which was and is to come. And when those beasts give glory and honor and thanks to him that sat on the throne, who liveth forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him that sat on the throne, and worship him that liveth forever and ever, and cast their crowns before the throne, saying, Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things.
Because at this hour, 40 Sphere, the 2 buildings, including the large black building that you see there, the 50-story 1 Liberty Plaza, and another building directly in front of it, which you cannot see, the Millennium Plaza, could be in imminent danger of collapsing. Until the rescue workers were evacuated, this was the situation here in Lower Manhattan and throughout the nation tonight.
As the day wears on, dump trucks and heavy equipment haul tons of debris from the toppled Twin Towers. Emotions grow taut. Exhausted city firefighters
track the tires that it takes to keep the car on the circle. Here, 38.5 miles an hour, up to 98%. At the limit, or 100% of the traction on the tires, you've got the car up to 38.75 miles per hour. Now, there's a radius that coincides with this. We're turning the car in a radius of 100 feet. What would happen if we decided to go faster than the side? No, it would take that extra speed, but it wouldn't on the same radius. The radius would only lift in this case to 106 feet. If we went faster still, the radius would increase once more.
This one should be enough to get you excited about how grand this technology is.
Now, here's the
reason that these robots would be able to save lives. In the United States, they kill about 33,000 people every year. 1.2 million people die in auto accidents around the world. By the way, only 1,800 is Great Britain, so it's doing pretty well. We're about 3.5 times better than the Americans per kilometer driven. But don't get too fussed. You kill a lot of people die. It's amazing the numbers that are coming from the well-paid accident in the
U.S.
American accident is a big deal. They calculate that accident. Per year. If you work it out per mile, it's about 8 cents a mile.
1.5% of 97 miles.
That's actually more expensive than gas. So when you're driving around in your Prius in California, it's not the law you have. You're actually spending more for your fear of accidents than you're spending on the gas. Now, robot contains it because 40% of those fatalities right now are hydrogen drinking. 93% of accidents come from not paying attention, just not looking. And that's the people the robots are having.
We're also losing 41 hours of our lives already to congestion every year. We have 3 parking spaces for every car. 60% of the land, potentially, in most cases, being able to drive away. Garages, parking lots, all these are drivers. Americans have to drive about half a light year every year, and great to build. Well, for a light month every year. You don't get to use light years and light months.
The line is welcome.
By the way, another thing that happens is Americans spend 50 billion hours every year exiting the streets. 50 billion hours, they only work 40 hours. This is a fact. The entire production output of that biggest part is spent. Now, there's not just this, but there's energy down the street. 25% of the energy developed is going toward the purpose of the line, and 25% of the industry. These numbers are huge, and these become vital. Computers can get into cars, why is it that? This is something we've been about trying to see, but now, in Silicon Valley, of course, they have a great garage innovation, and everyone's kind of amused that we actually have to do it in actual garages. This is not artificial intelligence making our computers smarter. Turns out driving is not that difficult. A horse. This is more artificial horse intelligence.
Let's go over.
Maybe even artificial bug intelligence, because bugs can swarm down like that. I'm not kidding. So, several years ago, the United States military started a series of contests to build these cars. In the first contest, nobody got more than 7 kilometers. My friend Anthony entered a motorcycle. He was a bit crazy. He forgot to turn it on. But the second contest had 5 people win going 150 miles through the desert. They went through rough terrain. The winner came from Stanford. Here you see their car driving down the road. It's going down a steep mountain ravine. Now, by the way, I'm showing you some of the cars that are making some progress. This winning car was followed up by a Carnegie Mellon car. And so the people who devised both these teams, this team and the Carnegie Mellon team, which won the contest after that, were hired by Google, where they built the next generation of cars. This is Chris Armisen, the chief engineer, pushing the button, and the vehicle going down the street to follow also, doing the ordinary things, ordinary driving in a city. Here we see it stopping at a stoplight, making a left turn. By the way, Google has said it thanks to these people for participating in this. Google Cloud's gone over 1 million kilometers on ordinary streets. Here's a little bit about how it's done. Seeing in all directions at once, 350 degrees, identifying everything in the world around. So they've taken the car through the streets of San Francisco into the left turn, the stop sign, the joggers who are running in front of the dog, going through the Golden Gate Bridge, going down the entire coast of California, the town of Monterey. We're speeding up a little bit here. Going along winding mountain roads, encountering things that frankly would frighten you if you were driving the road. And look, they're all on the other side of the road, so they're really scary. Night and day, the same to the vehicle. They even, for fun, took it down the windiest road in the world, known as the Lombard Street. So, we're also seeing different challenges by merging onto the highway, which is going to be one of the more challenging things. Here's the Stanford team teaching their car to park in where I don't actually get the highway.
Hit it right on the button.
He's
able to go 1 mile an hour.
How does this all happen now? You can actually buy a lot of this technology. In the showrooms right now, our cars can park themselves in the space, keep themselves in the lane, warn you if you're going to leave the lane, fix the distance in the car in front of you, leave the if you're about to run over a pedestrian, hit the brake for you if you ignore the beeping like an idiot. All of these things are in the showrooms today. The car companies are all jumping on and making out. Audi is going to have a product in a couple of years. They were showing it in CES. Nissan just started a lab in Silicon Valley where they're building cars. They were showing them in Tokyo 2 weeks ago. Actually, the team here at Oxford has been working together with Nissan and building cars that they're testing on British roads and even having to handle snow, which is actually one of the most common things. Nissan actually also announced that they would be selling cars in 2020. Throughout New Dam, Tesla is about 3 weeks ago now. They would have a car in 1996 that drove it. No, Tesla's actually a fun surprise. This is the last car I got to make up today. And every car's going to be on. And Mercedes also has announced that in 2020 they will be selling a car that can drive itself. Now, they actually have one you can buy in the showroom this year that installed the 2014 S-Class. It will handle the traffic at a very low speed, keep itself in the lane. But you can get to the lane, it's not scientific anymore. So the team at Google, I'm a tiny bit on this, put together a video showing a slightly more futuristic vision, not just on the highway, but a person running their errands for the day. So let's play that video.
Now, we can turn early, so we can turn late also.
also. This time, it certainly looks safer than the second time. This is big. This is the greatest experience of the soul. The symptom is that the second time.
Hey, how are you?
Do you think you're going to push the button there on the top floor?
Let's take a look at that first time. All the dragons.
Look, Mom.
No hands, no
hands, no hands.
So we're here at the stop sign.
Sodomite orders. Sodomite tells you anything, rest assured, it will be deceitful. It will lead you to ruin. Should you listen to the words they speak? So tell the world that you're not going to listen, because all of their advice is bad advice. I don't care what Grinder Greg or his black counterpart say.
Every time we have a story in the Bible about homosexuality, they're pretty much all they want to do is be strange. All they want to do. Isn't that what the Bible shows in Genesis 19? They just want to be with strangers. Judges 19, they want to be with strangers. That's all they want to do. Well, you know what? That's what the statistics show to be true. Where they have all the statistics showing that the average homo has been with hundreds of partners already. I think it was 43% of homos that have been with over 500 partners already. Why? Because they do that with strangers. Disgusting lifestyle. But what does the Bible say about homos? Look at verse 26. For this cause God gave them up unto vile affections. For even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. And likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one toward another, men with men, working that which is unseemly, and receiving themselves that recompense of their error which was meat. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. Being filled with, now stop and get this, he's saying that God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. Those things are the men with men and the women with women. That which is unseemly. Okay? Now, being filled is not starting a new sentence, is it? Being filled is not a complete thought. Being filled is saying that they do those things, and here's what they're also filled with. The same people. We haven't changed subjects here. We're on the same sentence. Okay? Notice at the end of verse 28 is a semicolon, and then we start out this new phrase, part of the same sentence, being filled with all unrighteousness. So according to the Bible, these that are men with men and women with women, they are filled with all unrighteousness, according to the Bible. They are also filled with fornication, which goes without saying. They are filled with wickedness. They are filled with covetousness. They are filled with maliciousness. They are full of envy. They are full of murder. They are full of debate, full of deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God that they would commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. Now, the Bible here is not painting a very pretty picture of that little pretty boy at work. Right? The Bible says this guy's filled with every kind of filth imaginable. He's violent, he's wicked, he's perverse, he's evil, he hates God, he's going to bite you in the back, he's a proud boaster, he's all these horrible things. That's what the Bible teaches. So, who's right? Is the world right when they say, oh, these two sodomites are just faithful with each other? They're just faithful with each other and they just love each other. Is that so bad? Or are they a violent predator who is not faithful to anybody because they're filled with all this deceit? They're a total covenant breaker. You know, oh, they want to have the covenant of marriage? What, just so they can break it?
And that sexual,
you know, the studies have shown, again, and you can, and I'm not talking about Christian studies. I'm saying you can go to AIDS.gov, go to CDC.gov, and they'll give you the statistics that homos are 50 times more likely to get AIDS than the average person. That's on the government's own website, okay? The same government that has an LGBT ambassador all over the world trying to promote queer rights all over the world. So, you know, their own statistics show that these people are filled with disease, and when they study their lifestyle, that they're with hundreds of partners, and that monogamy simply doesn't exist amongst these people.
And this morning, okay? I want to preach TV, a sermon about the country of other stories. Now, I preached various sermons about different countries in this world, and the purpose of preaching these sermons is that we might learn from the bad examples of others. You see, I've heard it said that experience is the best teacher, but often a better teacher than experience is when you look at someone else's experience. You know, I don't have to go out and get drunk or do drugs or make a fool of myself in order to figure out that that's not going to end well. I'd rather just look at someone else and keep that as a bad example and stay away from that. All throughout the Bible, sermons are preached against nations. But today, it doesn't really make any sense to preach against the Moabites, or the Ammonites, or the Perizzites, or the Hivites. It makes more sense to preach sermons that are relevant to the world that we live in today. And this sermon will have something for everyone in the auditorium today to learn. Why? Because there's no temptation taken us, but such as is common to man. Now, why preach a sermon against Japan? Because Japan is a godless nation. Japan is one of the nations in this world that has the lowest percentage of Christians. There are very few Christians in Japan, if you don't count Americans who are over there on military bases. I mean, there are very few Japanese people who are Christian. It's a tragedy. It's sad. We love those people. We wish that they would be saved. We'd love to see them embrace the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ and be saved. This is not a hateful sermon toward the people of Japan. They need to hear the truth, just like Americans need to hear the truth and be saved. But I'm going to preach to you this morning and show you that because of Japan's rejection of the gospel over the centuries, rejection of the word of God, rejection of the wisdom of God, they are suffering today. And there are many, many things in their country that are just terrible as a result of rejecting the wisdom of the Bible. And listen, if you reject the wisdom of God in your life, you'll end up the same way. If you walk down the same path that these people are going down, you'll end up at the same destination. And so it's a cautionary tale that you look at. And there's joy. Look at the current condition of Japan. Let's first of all look at the scriptures, then we'll get into some of the bad things that are going on in Japan right now and how we can learn from these and avoid these here in our personal lives in the United States. Look at Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 5. The Bible reads, "Behold, I have taught you statutes and judgments, even as the Lord my God commanded me, that ye should do so in the land where ye go to possess it. Keep therefore and do them, for this is your wisdom and your understanding in the sight of the nations, which shall hear all these statutes and say, surely this great nation is a wise and understanding people." You see, when people look at a nation, they're either going to look at that nation and say, "This is a wise and understanding people," or they're going to look at that nation and say, "Wow, how foolish. That's a bad example. I better not go down that road." And God is admonishing the Old Testament nation of Israel that if they would follow his word, keep his commandments, and fear the Lord, that other nations would look at them and say, "This is a wise and understanding people." He said, "The word of God is your wisdom. This is your wisdom. Not your own carnal understanding, but the wisdom that you gain from studying the Bible itself." Look at verse number 7. This is what they will continue to say. "For what nation is there so great who hath God so nigh unto them?" That means so near unto them. as the Lord our God is in all things that we call upon him for? And what nation is there so great that hath statutes and judgments so righteous as all this law which I set before you this day? Flip over to Psalm 33. So what the Bible's teaching us here is that what makes a nation great is following the Bible. What makes a nation godly and righteous, what makes a nation wise and understanding, what makes a nation prosperous is adherence to the Word of God. That is what makes it a great nation. The Bible says, righteousness exalteth a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. Look at Psalm 33, verse 10. The Bible says, the Lord bringeth the counsel of the heathen to naught. The heathen nations, nations that do not regard the Word of God. He said their counsel, their advice, what they believe is right. God brings all that to nothing. It's meaningless to him. The Lord bringeth the counsel of the heathen to naught. He maketh the devices of the people of none effect. The counsel of the Lord standeth forever, the thoughts of his heart to all generations. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, and the people whom he hath chosen for his inheritance. The Lord looketh from heaven. He beholdeth all the sons of men. From the place of his habitation, he looketh upon all the inhabitants of the earth. Here's a key phrase in verse 15. He fashioneth their hearts alike. He considereth all their works. What does that mean when the Bible says that God fashioneth their hearts alike? It means that people in America are just like people in Japan, are just like people in South America, are just like people in Germany. Look, people are people. Humans are humans. Whether in Africa, Asia, Europe, we're all human, we're all people, and all our hearts are fashioned alike by God. So what makes one nation a great nation and another nation a failure? Well, it just depends on whether or not their God is the Lord. It just depends on whether or not they respect and adhere to the Word of God. It's not about skin color. It's not about race. It's not about ethnicity. It's about the Word of God. Many people should lift up today Japan as being a great positive example and say, we should be like Japan. Look how great of a nation Japan is. But Japan is not a great nation. Now, they went through a period where they experienced a lot of financial prosperity about 20 years ago or so, when they were really thriving in the 90s, and they were second only to the United States and Germany as far as exports and financial prosperity, and pretty much the USA, Germany, and Japan were looked at as being, you know, some of the most prosperous nations in that time. But here's the thing, just because you have financial prosperity and a lot of exports, that doesn't mean that you're a great nation. It doesn't make you a great nation. You know, there are many people today who have all kinds of money and wealth, but I wouldn't want to trade places with them, because wealth and money is not the final pursuit of our lives. But even that is slipping away from Japan as their economy goes downhill and as they've lost that standing and no longer even have that financial prosperity that they had 27 years ago. Why is Japan in trouble today? Well, let me read for you this article. The Japanese now have one of the lowest fertility rates in the world, and at the same time, one of the highest longevity rates. As a result, the population is dropping rapidly and becoming increasingly weighted toward older people. After peaking 7 years ago at 128 million, Japan's population has been falling and is on a path to decline by about a million people a year. By 2060, the government estimates there will be just 87 million people in Japan. Nearly half of them will be over 65. Without a dramatic change in either the birth rate or its restrictive immigration policies, Japan simply won't have enough workers to support its retirees and will enter a demographic death spiral, yet the babies aren't coming. Now, this is not the blessing of God when a nation has one of the lowest birth rates, one of the lowest fertility rates in the world. Let's just look at some scripture on this and see what the Bible says, if this is the blessing of God. First of all, in Proverbs 14:28, the Bible reads, in the multitude of people is the king's honor, but in the want of people is the destruction. destruction of the prince. When people are lacking in the realm or in the kingdom, that is a bad thing. And this is going to have dramatic repercussions when they're not reproducing over there, the population's dropping, and half the people are going to be over 65. Who's going to care for them? Who's going to take care of them? We're facing something similar in the United States. People failing to just reproduce. In Japan, it's way worse. They have a major problem in this area. Let's see if this is the blessing of God. Go to Psalm 127. While you're turning to Psalm 127, I'm just going to read you a litany of verses here that show you that fruitfulness is a blessing from God, and that fruitlessness and not reproducing physically is a curse from God. The Bible says in Genesis chapter 1, verse 28, and God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply. Notice, he blessed them and said unto them, be fruitful and multiply. Genesis 9, 1, and God blessed Noah and his sons and said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. Genesis 9, 7, and you be ye fruitful and multiply, bring forth abundantly in the earth, and did I mention multiply therein? So God's being very, very repetitive here, saying, be fruitful, multiply, it's a blessing. Genesis 17, another blessing, I'll make thee exceeding fruitful, and I will make nations of thee, and kings shall come out of thee. In Genesis 17, God blesses Ishmael by telling him that he will be fruitful and multiply. Genesis 28, 3, and God Almighty bless thee, and make thee fruitful, and multiply thee, that thou mayest be a multitude of people. Genesis 35, 11, and God said unto him, I am God Almighty, be fruitful and multiply. A nation and a company of nations shall be of thee, and kings shall come out of thy loins. Genesis 48, 4, behold, I will make thee fruitful and multiply thee, and will make thee a multitude of people. Genesis 49, 22, Joseph is a fruitful bough. This is the verse I'm preaching on tonight. Joseph is a fruitful bough, even a fruitful bough by a well whose branches run over the wall. Exodus 1, 7, and the children of Israel were fruitful and increased abundantly and multiplied and waxed exceeding mighty, and the land was filled with them. Leviticus 26, 9, for I will have respect unto you and make you fruitful and multiply you and establish my covenant with you. Look, when God is blessing a nation, they're fruitful, they're multiplying. Lots of scripture to that effect. Now look, if you are only able to have one child, is when people attack us, Bible-believing preachers, and they say, why do you preach about homosexuality? Why do you keep bringing that up? Why are you so fixated on that? Why are you bringing that up? You guys are being crammed down our throat every stupid day. Not a day goes by that TV and the magazines and the newspapers aren't cramming this trash down our throat. And you know what? We didn't take this fight. The fight came to us. And you know what? I didn't write this book. And this book already predicted thousands of years ago that that's what would be happening. I mean, I didn't choose that, hey, in the end times, before the second coming of Christ, we're going to have to be ripping face about a bunch of perverts and homos, and that's going to be the big issue in America that everybody talks about every single day in America. Hey, I didn't choose that. I didn't even predict that. I thought my dad was wrong about that, okay? I didn't choose this fight. This fight has come to us, and you know what I say? Bring it on! Hey, look, whatever fight the devil wants to bring me, bring it on. Because I'll preach any part of the Bible, and I'm not saying any of it. I like all of it. But we didn't choose this.
Well, why do you make that your battle?
I didn't make that my battle. I preach 156 sermons a year. I preach every book of the Bible. I preach out of Genesis. I preach out of Exodus. I preach out of Leviticus. I preach out of Numbers. I preach out of Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. I preach on the gospel. I preach on heaven. I preach on hell. I preach on the deity of Christ. I preach on the Trinity. I preach on salvation by faith. I preach on the eternal security of the believer. I'm preaching on repentance. I'm preaching on this. I'm preaching on that. And then you preach on sodomy and all the cameras. I didn't choose that. They chose it. This has been their agenda. But you know what? They don't realize. They come in here because it's their agenda, their little narrative, their brainwashing campaign that they're a part of, whether they know it or not, or believe
You
know why they're here? They're here because their bosses want them. They're here to demonize Christianity. They're here to demonize God's people. But you know what? You can't even make us look. Take me out of context all you want. You know what? The stuff I say from the Bible is so true. Even out of context, I still like it. I mean, even the TV pieces where they attack me. Look, I'm watching all your guys' coverage the past 3 minutes. I got popcorn, and I'm thinking, man, he looks good on there. Yeah, tell him. I like all of it. I like it all. And you know what? But these people in the media, they're so deluded. They think, oh man, we put this on TV, man, everybody's going to hate Sacramento. You know what they don't realize, Brother Jimenez, is that half the people in Sacramento are sitting at home, and they're seeing you on TV, and they're saying, hey, there's a guy with some guts. There's a guy who's trying to tell him like it is. There's a guy that actually believes the Bible. And you know what? They just don't have the guts to say it. But they're sitting there at home, in the comfort of their home, saying, it's about time somebody told them. That's what they're saying. So all the media is doing is just helping get the word of God out. And you know what? The Apostle Paul talked about how some people were spreading the word of God for the wrong motives. You know, he said, they preach Christ even in fancy and strife. They preach with contention, trying to add affliction to our bonds, you know, trying to add persecution to us. But you know what? Hey, I just rejoice that people are hearing about Verity Baptist Church. Great! Because then they're going to tune in, and they're going to get the gospel, they're going to get the soul winning, they're going to get everything else he preaches 95% of the time when he's not talking about perverts, all the other good stuff from the Bible. They're going to tune in, and then, you know, some of these cowards, once they see him go through the storm, once they see him stand tall, see, a lot of people are sitting at home right now just wanting to see how it's all going to turn out. They want, look, nobody wants to get on board with a loser, with a quitter. Now, I know you're not a loser. I know you're not a quitter, but they're sitting back and they're watching. And let me tell you something. He's going to be like a rock because he's founded on the rock.
You can love based on your genitals. I'm Lacey Green. I love you all. Thanks for viewing. And I'll be back with a new episode next week.
Yeah, I've learned in this world it's either kill or be killed. And I will strike vengeance on whoever tries to deny me. I will get all the people who made fun of me and I will destroy them.
We just unleashed something that can't be stopped.
Whoa! I didn't see you there. My name is Michael Kroll. From the Pride. Today I'm here to endorse my new product. It's called It's good for healing and basically resurrecting dead ones.
This is Officer McPunch talking.
Yeah, Alpha's from the corner. What it was? You're not acting a cop.
I need backup.
No.
What are you standing there for? Get someone!